Buenas tardes, bienvenidos al Centro de Estudios Públicos. Es para nosotros un honor muy particular poder presentar hoy día a don Robert Lucas. En el día de ayer, en un encuentro con intelectuales, el presidente checo, el dramaturgo Václav Havel, enfatizaba que la lucha que lideró contra el comunismo se nutría del esfuerzo por vivir en la verdad. Lo ocurrido allí demuestra el magnetismo que ejerce ese llamado a la verdad. Lo ocurrido con la obra intelectual del profesor Robert Lucas demuestra en otro plano el poder de la verdad. El profesor Lucas es un hombre que, sin abandonar el circuito normal del trabajo de un profesor, del escritorio a la biblioteca, de la biblioteca a la sala de clases, ha logrado más influencia en las decisiones de las autoridades económicas que millares de afanosos y vocingleros autodenominados hombres públicos dedicados a tratar de influir haciendo noticia cada semana. Estoy pensando en lo que ha significado la teoría de las expectativas racionales como lente para observar lo que está detrás de los fenómenos económicos y como instrumento para calibrar el margen de maniobra que tiene la autoridad. La obra de Lucas combina el rigor de las formulaciones matemáticas y una relación aquilatable con los datos empíricos. El talante de sus trabajos no es ideológico ni excluyente, ni fanático o fundamentalista. Lucas es, lisa y llanamente, un científico. Ha seguido en economía el camino, tan exitoso en las ciencias de la naturaleza, de intentar modelar matemáticamente situaciones dinámicas, es decir, el movimiento. Un caso paradigmático de ello son las ecuaciones de Maxwell en el campo de la termodinámica. Por otra parte, ha tenido un interés serio por la historia, disciplina en la cual también obtuvo un grado académico. Los escritos de Lucas irradian una genuina preocupación por la verdad y sus matices. Como ocurre con todos los pensadores originales, sus ideas entran de inmediato en contacto con las de otros grandes y permiten verlas de nuevo. Estoy pensando en la forma en que las contribuciones de la teoría de las expectativas racionales de Lucas hace repensar a Milton Friedman y en especial a Lord Keynes, o en cómo, más recientemente, sus reflexiones sobre el crecimiento económico lo ponen en diálogo no solo con un Robert Solow, sino con Malthus, Ricardo y Adam Smith. Sin embargo, lo que subyace a las formalizaciones matemáticas de Lucas es, si lo interpreto bien, una cierta visión de lo que es el ser humano, más precisamente de su capacidad para repensar su conducta y cambiarla. La teoría de las expectativas racionales ha sido una revolución copernicana para la macroeconomía. En su centro hay una intuición fundamental: el ser humano, al actuar, recuerda y anticipa. Memoria del pasado y visión del futuro son los ingredientes que permiten a las personas tomar decisiones y modificar conductas. Así, por ejemplo, las resoluciones y políticas de la autoridad que procuran obtener ciertos resultados se frustran en la medida en que la gente, conocedora por experiencia de sus costos, modifica su comportamiento y se pone a resguardo de ellos. Esto pone un límite muy real a lo que las conductas de las autoridades pueden intentar manipular con éxito. La tesis hasta cierto punto se emparenta con la crítica que Karl Popper hizo a las teorías historicistas que, como el marxismo, creían posible determinar las leyes de la evolución histórica y a partir de ello afirmaban conocer con certeza las formas sociales futuras que pasaban a ser entonces inevitables y predecibles. La objeción de Popper fue que estas teorías no tomaban en cuenta lo que llamó la aparición de la novedad, es decir, la expansión del conocimiento. La mera aparición de una predicción de la sociedad del futuro y de un conjunto de políticas diseñadas en función de ello genera de por sí un hecho nuevo ante el cual los seres humanos reaccionarán de un modo que dicha predicción ya no puede controlar. El mundo económico, tal como nos aparece después de Lucas, está configurado en importante medida por las expectativas, es decir, por algo que no es el futuro, pero al cual nuestra mente le da actualidad y por tanto fuerza para actuar en lo que es en el presente. El dato económico, un precio, un valor, por ejemplo, contiene, por así decir, en su interior, un componente que recoge las expectativas. No es un dato bruto, es un dato humano. Porque como lo mostrara de un modo genial Samuel Beckett en Esperando a Godot, es propio de los humanos vivir a la expectativa. En su trabajo Haciendo un milagro, de 1993, Robert Lucas examina los casos de Corea y Filipinas, sociedades que en 1960 eran similares, por ejemplo, en producto ingreso, en PIB per cápita, en población, en escolaridad. Pero como sabemos, la historia posterior muestra enormes diferencias en cuanto a crecimiento. Mientras Filipinas, entre esa fecha y 1988, crece a una tasa de 1,8% promedio por año, Corea lo hace a una tasa de 6,2%, lo cual significa doblar el ingreso per cápita cada 11 años. ¿Cómo explicar el rápido y sostenido crecimiento de Corea versus Filipinas? La sugerencia de Lucas es que esto se debe al rápido incremento del capital humano que tiene lugar en Corea. Este proceso de acumulación de conocimientos se habría producido no tanto por la vía de la educación formal, sino más bien en el trabajo. La idea es que el propio intercambio comercial y los rigores de la competencia internacional indujeron un acelerado proceso de aprendizaje en el hacer, es decir, en el trabajo mismo. Sociedades como Corea, al entrar en contacto con economías altamente desarrolladas, lograron aprender de ellas y dar el salto. Otra vez, lo que subyace a la teoría es una cierta visión del ser humano, la intuición de que ante el desafío las personas revisan y modifican sus conductas. Ante el ejemplo de las tecnologías ajenas, brota la capacidad de aprender y de emular. Creo que en el fondo, lo que le da al pensamiento de Lucas su profundidad es esta apuesta que hace una y otra vez por la capacidad humana de pensar y de repensar, de recordar y anticipar, de revisar y corregir rumbos. Así como hay en su obra un amor a la representación matemática de la realidad, hay en ella, por otro lado, una vertiente humanística muy honda. Muchas gracias.
Well, thank you very much for a very generous introduction. And thanks as well for making possible my first visit to Chile, which is a very exciting and pleasant experience. My paper is The Industrial Revolution, Past and Future. We live in a world of staggering and unprecedented income inequality. Production per person in the United States is something like 25 times production per person in the poorest economies of Africa and South Asia. Since the 1950s, several East Asian economies have grown from being among the very poorest in the world to middle-income societies, with living standards exceeding one-third of America's. How are we to interpret these remarkable economic successes, successes so dramatic that many people refer to them as miracles? In the same period, other economies whose prospects in 1960 appeared much brighter than Korea's or Taiwan's have stagnated, falling farther behind the living standards of the richest countries. Is East Asian growth since 1960 a model of what poor nations can hope to achieve in the 21st century? Can everyone have an economic miracle? Or is economic growth a kind of zero-sum game in the sense that some countries' economic success necessarily comes at the expense of some other country's economic failure? No one really knows the answers to questions like this, I know. But my hope is that if we look at the right evidence organized in the right way, we can get very close to a coherent and reliable view of the changes in the wealth of nations that have occurred in the last century and those that are likely to occur in the next one. The post-war experience of any particular country is only one chapter in the larger story of the world economy since World War II, and that story in turn is only one chapter of the history of the Industrial Revolution. In this lecture, I'll try to set out what I see as the main facts of the economic history of the recent past, with a minimum of theoretical interpretation, and then try and see what answers they suggest about the future. I'm going to begin and end with numbers. Economic growth is a quantitative matter. I'll start with it with a description of the world economy in the post-war period, which is the period where we have by far the most reliable data. Then I'll talk about the economic history of the world up to about the time Adam Smith and David Ricardo were founding modern economics. And I think we know most the main outlines of that period too. And finally, I'll look at the Industrial Revolution, that is to say the transition from the pre-1800 world to the modern world. There are four figures in the text, and when I come to the Center for Public Studies, I find that they have redone all my figures in color, which I call extremely good service. So what I'm going to put up on the screen are the center's figures and not mine. You'll appreciate when you see them. And I'm going to go out of order and put figure two first, because figure two really defines, will let me define what I mean by the Industrial Revolution. What is this? Can I do something useful with this? I've never had one of these in my hands before. We got plots of population and production for the total world economy, and starting from the year 1000 to the year 2000, or really, 1990. The top red curve is population. The bottom curve is total production, GDP. I guess there's no distinction between GDP and GNP when you're talking about the entire world. And the and the vertical scale is either population in millions or production in billions of 1985 U.S. dollars. And the thing to note is that the vertical scale is a log scale, so the numbers are 100, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000. So that means that a series growing at a constant percentage rate of growth would appear as a straight line on the picture. Now, if you look at the production and population series up to about 1800, they're parallel. I'll tell you why in a while. But so if they're either both straight lines or neither. It seems to me they're both have a pretty constant slope up to about 1800. And from something like 1800 on, both the growth in both population and production accelerates rapidly. I'll give some numbers in a moment. difference between these two curves is a log of per capita income. So during the phase which goes up to around 1800, when these two curves are parallel, per capita, that's the same thing as saying that per capita income is constant over those periods, and the level they're constant is about 600 US dollars. So that's in about 1900, these two curves cross, which means that average world income has risen to about 1,000 US dollars. By 1990, the production curve is far above the population curve, and per capita income in 1990 in the world is up to about $4,000. So we see a picture of a world in which living standards are basically unchanging for eight centuries, and if I ran this curve back to the expulsion from the garden, these series would still be parallel. Okay, so you got a world of stable living standards, at least no trend in living standards. Of course, plagues and technological changes both move income around, but it seems to me there's a tendency for income to return to some stable level. And then around 1800, we're in a new world in which living standards are increasing and at an accelerating pace. And it's that event, this change in the nature of the human situation that we call the Industrial Revolution. So by industrial, I don't mean to suggest heavy things like steel mills and coal mines. I just mean that the ability of us, our ability to produce goods and services started growing at an accelerating rate about 200 years ago. Now, let me return to the post-war period, which is shown on that diagram, but it's such a small, you know, you can't really read the numbers off that figure. So I want to give you some numbers describing the post-war world. And again, every number I give you is for the entire world. The world population in 1960 was around 3 billion, and by 1990, it's 5.2 billion. So this is an annual growth rate of 1.8% per 8%. Obviously, the number of people in the world can't grow forever at 2% per year, and a lot of people, exponents of what one of my friends calls the economics of gloom, write as though the human race is kind of breeding itself into destruction. We're outstripping the world's resources. We're in a regime of increasing poverty and decreasing available resources. But this view has absolutely nothing to do with the economic data that we have. Of course, there's a good deal of poverty and starvation in this world, but it's completely, nothing could be further from the truth than the idea that poverty is increasing. Over this period, 60 to 90, when population has grown from 3 billion to 5.2 billion, total production grew much faster than population, from 6.5 trillion in 1960 to 21.8 trillion in 1990. So world production more than tripled over this 30-year period with an annual growth rate of 4%. So combining that with the population figures, that means that production per person grew at 2.2% per year, which is to say that the living standard of the average world citizen nearly doubled between 60 and 90. Now understand, I'm not talking about the advanced economies, the OECD, or some East Asian miracles. All these numbers, I'm not excluding the Africans or the communists, so all these numbers refer to the entire world. That means that the living standards in the entire world since 1960 are growing faster than living standards in the United States have ever grown in over a 30-year period. The entire human race is getting rich at historically unprecedented rates. Of course, the miracles of East Asia are unusual in their magnitudes, but economic growth is the rule in the world today, not an exception. Now, of course, there's a great deal of diversity in this picture, in the post-war world that's not reflected in these world totals. So I'm going to trade figure 2 for figure 1. And this figure is kind of a histogram of the world. It's a crude picture of the distribution of income in the world in 1960 and 1990. Now, the data I'm working with for the entire post-war period is this marvelous data set that Robert Summers and Alan Heston created, the Penn World Table. So these are data for countries. I have no data on income distribution within countries. So when I talk about the world distribution, I'm treating everybody in the world as though he's got his country's average income. Okay. and of course, that's not true. But without going deeper into the data on individual countries' income distribution, this is the best I can do, and it's informative. I've got the histogram. There's really 8 points plotted on this curve, and I just connected the dots. The dots are just the nodes. The red curve refers to the income distribution in 1960. The blue curve for 1990. So if you look at this dot here, the horizontal axis is per capita GDP, and it's a log scale. The vertical axis is millions of people, and it's in a natural unit scale. So this point says that let's talk about 1960 first. This point says that in 1960, about 1.7 billion people lived in countries with mean incomes less than $1,100. And about 700 million people lived in countries with mean incomes between $1,100 and $3,000 US dollars, and so on. So the 4 points in the red curve sum to 3 billion, because that's how many people there were in the world in 1960, and then the 4 points in the blue curve sum to 5.2 billion, because that's how many people there were in 1990. So what you can see is that the absolute number, of course the fraction, but even stronger, the absolute number of people living in the poorest bracket dropped from 1960 to 1990 by a factor of 3. And in general, you can see that the two highest, all the other brackets increased in number. If you had good enough eyes, you could read the rate of growth of population and the rate of growth of production off this picture. But in any case, you can sort of see that the distribution is shifting out without much change in the degree of inequality. Or at least that's what I'm not able to read any. I can't tell whether over this 30-year period income is getting less equally distributed or more equally distributed. Seems like the degree of inequality is kind of staying about the same while everyone's income is growing. There's been an enormous amount of recent empirical work focused on the question, on exactly this question, of whether per capita incomes are converging to a common level or possibly diverging. And most of this work uses exactly the same data set that I used to construct this figure. And it seems to me if you just look at that figure, you can see that there's not going to be a high return to a more sophisticated econometric studies of this time period, that is a 30-year time period, is just not long enough to answer this question. You can't tell. If that's all the evidence you had, I don't think we could tell whether world incomes are getting less or more equal. So rather than try and do a more sophisticated analysis of this 30-year period, what I'd like to do is to get outside this period and go back in history and sort of try and look at the world situation from which that distribution evolved. Now, I guess before I do that, you've got a right to know how I'm going to know what GDP was in, you know, China in the 12th century. Now, the population side, I'm going to take from the demographers. They're estimates that are not very controversial. Population of societies going way back before, you know, the year 1000, certainly way back before 1800. And I'm going to take them from sources without being very critical of them. As an economist, then I want to think about estimating product. In the front hall of my Chicago apartment, I got a painting of an agricultural scene that a Korean student gave me some years back. In the painting, and I don't exactly know the period when it was painted or the period to which it refers, it's a farmer plowing his field behind his ox. He's got fruit trees flowering. It's a spring scene. And mountains in the background, and it's a very, very attractive picture and has a sense of calm serenity about it. There's a lot of economics in this picture, if you look at it the right way. We know about what one farmer and one ox can, how much plowing, how big a field he can plow. We know a lot about the kind of seeds he was using. We know a lot about the yield per farm for this farmer. And we know everything about how much it would have cost to buy the output of that farm in the United States in 1985. As you know, the 1985 US dollar value of that stuff. We can look at his trees. We know about how many apples you get per apple tree, and we know what apples sold for in the U.S. in 1985. So we can kind of look at this fellow's farm and estimate his production. If we did that, I actually haven't done it, but if one did it, you get to something around $2,000. So if this farmer's got a wife and two children, he's living in a 500 U.S. dollar per capita income society. So that's one farmer. But we also know that in a traditional agricultural society, which is what Korea was up until the very recent past, virtually everyone is engaged in traditional agriculture. So this farmer is, we can just replicate him by how many people there are in Korea and get what I think is a pretty reliable estimate of income in Korea. So we know a lot about individual living standards in historical societies, even when there wasn't any national income accounting done in those societies. We know about consumption patterns, we know about production patterns. Second source of information about poor societies in ancient times is the evidence we got on traditional agricultural societies in modern times. So we can see how much farmers produce in Bangladesh or China in 1960. These are societies with per capita incomes of something like $500 or $600 US, and it doesn't seem to me you can get much lower than that. So that there's a kind of subsistence floor on that traditional society, and there were many societies that must have been pretty close to that floor in 1960, and we've got lots of evidence on those. Well, it seems to me that the estimating incomes in poor traditional agricultural societies is in some sense a lot easier than measuring product in a complicated modern society. In any event, what I have done is I'm tracing each country back to there's a lot of evidence on the currently wealthy societies like the United States or UK going way back into the 19th century. Extrapolating these figures back till around $600 US, and then assuming they were there forever. And it's on that basis that I'm building series on world production and world income. So I'm not going to discover the constancy of per capita incomes, I'm going to assert it as an assumption. And it's those assumptions that underlie the series. Maybe we should just put it back up. What I've done is describe the sources for that series. From 1960 on, I just added up across countries in the Penn World table. For 1960 backwards, I used historical studies of the rich societies and extrapolated the poor societies based on the methods and the reasoning I just described. And from kind of those three sources, I got the economic history of the world from 1000 on. And once you get the hang of it, you can see I could have gone back as far as I wanted. I want to make two disclaimers, both of which are illustrated on this picture, or one of which is. I'm going to keep referring to these traditional agricultural societies as stagnant. But they weren't stagnant in a technological sense. Anyone can list economically important advances in technology that occurred way before 1800. And it's, in fact, it's our continued ability to find technological improvements that sustained this enormous population growth of the human race for as far back as we've got data. I mean, human beings are a very successful species. And which means we must have been able to find new ways of producing goods and services, mainly food, over the centuries. So the technological change is not the defining characteristic of the onset of the Industrial Revolution, because we've always had technical change. The difference has to do not with whether or not a society, the difference between a traditional and a modern society is not one of the presence or absence of technical change. It's more a matter of what you do with that technical change. Some societies choose to increase population when the technology improves. Some, in recent years, choose to improve living standards. It's the differences in that choice that distinguish modern from traditional societies. I'll probably slip into calling these traditional societies subsistence economies. But of course, high civilizations were supported in many societies in many places way before 1800. So clearly, not everybody in these societies is living on $600 per year. Society works. In an agricultural society, about 30 to 40% of the income goes to landowners, and the rest to labor. And if you have a large country with a lot of subsistence farmers and a small group of landowners, you can have an enormously wealthy ruling class or landowner class combined with the sort of Malthusian mechanics that I've been describing. So I don't mean to say when I talk about traditional societies that traditional societies weren't able to support high civilizations. They obviously were. What they were not able to do is to generate improvements in the living standards of masses of people. The Korean farmer in my hallway could be in any century in the last 1,000 years. You don't have to redo the picture to record the passage of time in his world. On the other hand, if the living standard in these traditional economies was low, it was also equal. At the beginning of the revolution, different societies in different parts of the world had about the same overall living standard. In the beginning of the colonial period, the advantage of the Europeans was military, not economic. The Spanish conquerors of Mexico wrote of how impressed they were with the variety and quality of goods that were for sale in Aztec markets. My guess is the living standard in Spain and pre-Columbian Mexico, in the sense of per capita income, was about the same. The Spanish advantage was military, navigational. There are many differences in the technology available to the two societies, but not differences in their average income levels. The arguments in the classical writings like Smith's and Ricardo's, because they were intensely interested in this question of income differences across societies, neither of them makes any reference to sustained growth in living standards. I'll comment on that in a minute. Neither of them seem to me to be talking about differences even close to a factor of two. So when Smith talks about the wealth of nations, he's talking about a level change, and a level change that's small compared. I mean, the difference between Indian and American income is a factor of 25. There's no reference in any of the old writers to income differentials of that anywhere near that magnitude. Now, the Industrial Revolution affected different parts of the world in different ways. So I'm going to move to a figure. I should have given you all of them at once, but I didn't think of it. It's kind of twisted. I'll tell you what.
It turns out there's a little minor errors in the bottom. I only want you to see that part.
What we covered up with some labels, and I'm going to give you the labels in words. What I'd like to be able to do is to trace out per capita income levels. Here I'm going from 1750 to 2000. But I've already argued that before 1750, there's nothing interesting in the history of human per capita incomes anyway. And on the vertical axis, I've got per capita income in thousands of U.S. dollars. I'd like to plot out the course of per capita income growth in all the countries of the world, but there's way too many of them. So what I've done is broken the world down into groups, and there's a lot of arbitrariness in how I've done it. And the number of groups is that I just didn't want to clutter the graph too much. Then I added Chile because I'm a guest in your country, and it was only courtesy to give Chile some special play. So group one is the English-speaking countries. So it's England and then the U.S. and Canada, Australia, New Zealand. And as we know, the Industrial Revolution started in England, and that's this red curve. And you can see that the growth of per capita income in the English-speaking world sort of departed from this 600 U.S. dollar level sometime around 1800, and has grown at a pretty steady rate up to its present level. The number on the right up there is just the population of that. There's 384 million people in that group in 1990. I didn't want to leave this off because without these population labels, you'd think all these curves are equally important. I don't want to offend you, but I don't think 13 million Chileans weigh in very well against 3.5 billion Asians and Africans. So. All right, the second curve, this sort of golden line, is Japan. And I haven't given this lecture in Japan, but Japan is such an exciting country that I couldn't bear to average it in with the other Asians. So here it is. Then this blue line, which starts out in second place, but by the end of the curve is slightly in third place, is the rest of Northern Europe. So it's France, Germany, the Low Countries, and Scandinavia. You can see they kind of start off behind the English-speaking countries, but then sometime in the post-war period, they took off and closed that gap a lot. So you can see these top three curves are all a lot further apart at 1950 than they are in the top curve. Now the dotted curve is the rest of Europe, so Southern Europe, Eastern Europe, including the communists, and Latin America. Now by Europe, then I don't mean people necessarily living in the continent of Europe. I mean countries that are controlled by people whose ancestors lived in the continent of Europe. And you can see that the grouping, for example, Italy, is then lumped in with this dotted curve. And of course, maybe I should have broken out because, you know, Italy's way up here now. So I've kind of averaged some really successful European countries with the communist countries, which, you know. Okay. Then the bottom group is Asia, excluding Japan, and Africa. Africa. And there's most of the people in the world are in that group. So I started out by giving you some numbers and figures about inequality in the world. And you can see that if you start back here at about 1800, basically none of this inequality had emerged yet. I mean, the natural state of the human race is that we're all about, across societies, we're all about equally well off. And if you look at, for example, that's the data set that Smith and Ricardo were looking at, and Malthus. And so they constructed a theory which explained how it is that there's a stable living standard to which societies tend to return from after being displaced. And, you know, they were successful by the standard. They designed a theory that fit the facts as they knew them. Here we are at time that Marx and Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto. By this time, Marx and Engels, anyway, can see there's something going on that just didn't. That's really brand new, and worth writing about. And but they don't think it can go on forever, which also seems to me not a nowadays. We make a lot out of Marx's bad predictions, but it's, you know, he can be excused, I think, given the evidence before him. By about 1900, there's a 6-to-1 difference in income between Europeans and non-Europeans on average, so that by this time everybody knows something's happening in this world, and people start trying to think about the question, why are we Europeans so much better than everybody else in the world? And advance various theories like the, or Northern Europeans, maybe, so the connections between the Protestant ethic and economic growth. But it's clear something special about, or it seems that something special about European culture or European genes or something is making us different from everybody else. It seems to me, as you go from 1900 to 1950, the inequality just blows up without changing in character very much. So the rich are getting richer and the poor. Look at the Asian African group. This curve is completely flat until the end of the colonial period. There is no growth in living standards in Asia and Africa as a whole until 1950. So given that you've got a huge part of the world in a zero growth situation and the rest of the world at various stages of rapid growth, you know, you can see where this 25-to-1 differences in living standards comes from. On the other hand, you can see the Japanese economy. Look how poor Japan was in World War II, or up through the 30s. And then the whole Japanese miracle is a post-war event, and here it is. And you can see that the former colonies of Africa and Asia start to grow. The growth in total production in those economies is actually quite impressive. But the population growth is enormous as well, so the per capita income growth is pretty modest. But you know, it's definitely an advance over the colonial. Independence has been a better period for those parts of the world than the colonial situation was. So in the post-war world, as I said, from 1900 to 1950, it just seems like the distribution of income just expanded. In the post-war world, you can see the different picture, and you've known this from other sources, of a certain set of countries converging to a common living standard, Japan, the United States, and the European common market countries, leaving the rest of the world farther behind. So it's that mix that we're seeing in that histogram that I put on the board, put on the screen a little while ago. I'm going to show one more figure. I've argued that it's not technical change that's the defining characteristic of the Industrial Revolution, but some combination of technical change and changes in fertility behavior and population growth. Somehow we got out of this Malthusian behavior. And this is a well-known fact, which people call it demographic transition. And here's a picture of the demographic transition. I got these five country groups. And each curve then traces the history of one of those groups from 1750 to the present day. This axis is per capita income in thousands of U.S. dollars. This axis is the annual rate of population growth. So all these series begin back here at 600 U.S. dollars, because that's what we were all making way back when, in 1800. Then as these societies begin to grow, the curves shoot up. So population growth is increasing as per capita income increases. So these increases here, you see it in the black curve, which is Asia and Africa. And of course, this is a fairly recent event for Africa and Asia, because there wasn't any per capita income growth until recently for those countries. But you can see it in Japan over this period. You can see it in the English-speaking countries. They're all responding just like Malthus said they would. Growth in per capita income stimulates an increase in population, which, of course, is going to drive the per capita income back down. And then at some income level, not that high, these curves all start to turn down again. And it's that turning down is that people call the demographic transition. As economic growth continues, it begins to come out more and more. Technological change begins to come out more and more in living standard changes and less in population changes. And you know, what I'd like to do is to put figure 3 back up and leave it, because it's so beautiful. Well, what I've tried to do is to give a sort of mental picture of the Industrial Revolution up to the present date. Now I'd like to ask where these series are going from here on out. So what's the 21st century going to look like if we just extend this picture to the right? Now, the right way to answer that question, the most useful and trustworthy way, would be to construct some kind of economic model that fits the various aspects of that picture, and then use that model to simulate that model to try and see where the system is going. And along with many other economists, you know, I'm actively engaged in trying to carry out that construction of that type. What's hard, I think, is the as I said before, I think we just lift from Ricardo's principles a very adequate model of production and population behavior to account for what we've seen up to about the time Ricardo wrote, about 1800. So for recent years, for the advanced countries, I think these kind of modern versions of Solow's original model of growth do a pretty good job of accounting for sustained growth. But what we need to do is somehow understand this transition. At what point and for what reasons and did this sort of Ricardo Malthusian world start to look like a Solow world or a Paul Romer world with sustained economic growth? I think to answer that question is going to involve somehow integrating a fertility decision into the growth model. But and part of this paper is trying to sketch some ideas related to that construction, and I encourage you to read the paper. But I guess when you finish reading it, you're not going to know the answer to the question. I don't believe this theoretical problem is solved. So I'm not really capable of carrying out the simulation I'd like to carry out. So what I'm going to do is to try and extrapolate into the future in a much cruder and less economic theory intensive fashion. And conclude the paper. We've talked about this accelerating growth of production in the post-war period and the enormous amount of inequality across countries. I don't think either one of those situations can persist forever or even for another century. What we're seeing in the 20th century, or certainly the second half of the 20th century, the major event, I think, is the diffusion of the Industrial Revolution to the non-European world. It's also got to complete its course in the European world. So it's obvious by now that there's no connection between, let's say, Protestantism or Europeanism and economic growth, that anybody can do it. Lots of non-European economies that have led by Japan, led in time by Japan, that have made the full transition, and there's no doubt the Industrial Revolution is a European event in the sense that it began there, but it's not going to be confined to there, and that's not a prediction, that's just an observation. So I think this diffusion is going to continue. The technology that makes the Industrial Revolution possible is can spread anywhere, and the fertility behavior that leads societies to respond by cutting back population growth, every group of MiFi has turned that corner. The Asians and Africans have just done it. So that too is in some sense universal. So the rapid growth in the post-war world is mainly due to the catch-up growth due to the countries that are kind of late arrivals to the Industrial Revolution. As more and more countries make that transition, more and more of us will be developed countries that grow at modest rates between 1 and 2% per capita income, and less of us will have any catching up to do. And that means that the average world growth rate is going to fall back again from this 4%. Maybe it'll get above the 4% it's been in the last 30 years, but at some point it's going to fall back again to something more like 2 or 3%. On the other hand, in the process of growth rates, the reason that growth rates will converge is because income levels are going to be converging. If the poorest countries are growing faster than the rich countries, then income levels have to be converging to common levels. So roughly speaking, it seems to me that at the end of the 21st century, countries are going to look a lot more like the United States, in both in their rates of growth and in their income levels, than they do now. The inequality in income, what I've tried to show, equality in income is the normal state of the human race. Human capabilities and human behaviors are pretty much the same in all societies and behaved about the same way for all the history we have up until about 1800. There's no reason why Americans should be able to produce 25 times as much as other people. It's an unnatural situation. It's not based on any fundamental differences between peoples. It's based on accidents of history, in my opinion. And given that, I think we're going to return to what I view as a more natural situation in which incomes are roughly constant across countries. I want to say some things, maybe more to stimulate discussion than to settle anything. Of course, we care. I've said everybody, sooner or later, everybody's going to catch up. But a lot of people think it's important to be sooner rather than later, and I agree. So you can ask, what kind of policies in a country like Pakistan or Nigeria that hasn't really begun this transition, What would foster success? What would make them early catchers up rather than late? I think the central element for backward economies is dealing on a day-to-day basis with more advanced economies. We've observed no development successes for isolated economies, for import substitution strategies. Perhaps Russia in the 20s or India in the 50s can be said to have successful growth with an import substitution strategies, but we're not here talking about a 10-year spurt. We're talking about sustained economic growth. I suppose one reason trade and interaction is important is that it lets smaller countries attain efficient scale, but I don't think it has so much to do with small versus large countries. China's big enough to attain efficient scale all by itself, and I don't believe Chinese productivity could grow in isolation with the rest of the world. I think that learning by doing is the most important form of human capital accumulation, and the transfer of technology from the leaders to the poor countries can only take place if people are interacting, are working together. And the only way countries have brought themselves up to international standards is by competing internationally. I don't think there's any. I can't think of any exceptions to that. So, in some sense, openness of an economy is essential. But I don't want to be doctrinaire. I can't be. The data doesn't let me be doctrinaire. What I mean by openness, obviously, Japan, Korea, have followed heavily managed trade policies. I don't believe anyone's demonstrated that this management has actually made a positive contribution to their growth behavior. But on the same time, it's obvious it hasn't been inconsistent with impressive growth behavior. But Japan and Korea have not, in spite of all their trade restrictions, have not cut themselves off from the rest of the world. They haven't tried to follow a Japanese way or a Korean way. They've joined the world economy. They've competed in the world economy. They brought their production methods up to world economy standards, and that just has been a central fact in their closing of this income gap. On the other hand, macroeconomic policy doesn't seem to me to be very central to growth. Chairman of my department, Jose Schenkman, says, "Bob, you can't go to Argentina and Chile and say things like that." But I'm talking about a kind of normal. Obviously, these devastating hyperinflations that are fatal to any kind of decent economic performance. I guess what I mean is that in some kind of more normal range of inflation, it doesn't seem essential to have decent macroeconomic policy to grow. Korea, Brazil, Indonesia have all enjoyed long periods of pretty successful growth under very bad macroeconomic policies. Of course, many other countries have had bad experiences under inflationary policies. I'm not arguing inflation is harmless. I think it's a very resource-wasting process. But I don't see any intimate connections between inflation policy and growth in the data. I want to conclude with a disclaimer. I've spent a lot of time talking about inequality, about income distribution around the world. If I had the data, I would have talked about income distribution within countries as well. But there's no tendency more harmful to sound economics, in my opinion, but it's also a very seductive tendency, than focusing on questions of distribution. I mean, right now, a child is being born to an American family and another child to an Indian family, equally loved by God, but the resources at the disposal of the American child will be 25 times the resources at the disposal of the Indian child. This is simply an accident of history. There's no justice to it. There's no reason for it in some sense. And all our instincts are that if we could do it, we'd take some of those resources from the rich child and move them, give them to the poor child. And it may well be that there are possibilities for that kind of redistribution that should be taken. But it seemed to me that the lesson of the history that I've tried to display here is that in the vast improvement in living standards for millions of people that the Industrial Revolution has brought, virtually none of this improvement can be attributed to policies that directed at redistributing the existing volume of production. And all of the improvement has taken place from growth in our ability to produce. That the potential for improving the lives of poor people by different ways of allocating current production levels is trivial compared to the apparently limitless potential of increasing production through increases in knowledge. Thank you.
Se ofrece la palabra. A ver, una pregunta, profesor Locke. I think you should use one of these things now. A ver, en la curva de la caída de la fertilidad, ¿cómo se explica eso? ¿Cómo se explica la caída de la fertilidad en el momento en que justamente comienza a haber más riqueza? ¿Qué plantearía usted sobre eso?
I just caught the last of the question, I'm sorry.
La curva de caída de la fertilidad, de caída de la población, se produce en el momento en que hay un aumento de ingresos. ¿Qué teoría aceptaría usted para explicar ese fenómeno?
That's... No, it's completely clear. I'm just trying to get an equally clear answer, which may not be. But let's put the picture called the demographic transition, figure four. Let's put figure four back on. All right, so the question is. Okay, now I've got to take this out. Because I. We're going to try and explain this curve, this downturn, this fertility behavior. How would we go about doing it? This is a question that Gary Becker addressed in the 60s, or at least work he did in the 60s, I think is very relevant to it. We like children, and as we get richer, we want to have more of the things we like, so in some sense it's not surprising that with increasing wealth we have more children. But that response to increasing wealth doesn't hold throughout the entire range of that figure. So there must be some other dimension, something else that's changing along with income. We don't start hating children after we get above 6,000, you know, U.S. dollars. Must be some other dimension of childbearing that comes into play for higher income societies if we're going to account for this figure. Okay, now what Becker proposed is that along with the quantity of children, which we regard as good, there's a dimension of quality of children. We care about, you know, the not only the number of children, but the quality of the life that we're able to provide for each one of those children, and we'd like improvement along that dimension too. And then as societies get richer, this quality dimension becomes more starts to outweigh the quantity dimension. Now, a point in favor of Becker's explanation is that if I had plotted expenditures on children against income levels, that curve wouldn't turn down. It keeps growing. So as we get richer, we spend more on our children. But the character of the expenditure changes. So instead of as we double our income, we don't double the number of children, but we improve the college, or we send our child to, or the bequest we leave to the child, or maybe just the time we spend with that child. But in some way or another, we're investing more per child. Becker used this model to account for differences across income groups in the United States, different fertility levels. Poor people have more children, by and large, than rich people in the U.S. Seems to me that is a promising route for thinking about this demographic transition. Now, if the route's going to work, then the theory's got to have within it a reason for this switch from quantity to quality. And I think that reason lies in the fact that as a society develops, and there's an increase to the return to investments in human capital. So the reason we switch to spending more time with each child, let's say, rather than having more children, is that in a developing society, our investment in our child can make big differences in the child's future. I mean, in a traditional agricultural society, what's the point of teaching Johnny to read if he's just going to replace me behind that ox? You know, he doesn't really have to know anything, or he has to know how to, you know, guide an ox. In a developing society, where my child is going to be operating in a very different world from the one I grew up in, it becomes rewarding financially and otherwise for a parent to invest more in the child. And I think something like that is at work. Something obviously in the data connecting economic development with this quantity-quality trade-off. And I think it's got to work through the changes in this return to human capital. So for me, that's just one more reason for thinking human capital is kind of at the center of the story of economic growth, because besides explaining increases in productivity, I think it explains changes in the behavior of fertility.
Profesor Lucas, le quería hacer dos preguntas. La primera es, ¿cuál es el rol que se le adjudica en esta visión del proceso de crecimiento a las instituciones? Y la segunda es, dado que la inflación es un fenómeno básicamente del siglo XX y que por lo tanto la perspectiva de los números que estamos viendo aparece como concentrada en un periodo muy corto, ¿en qué medida podemos decir algo más definitivo respecto al rol de la inflación sobre el crecimiento, no solamente como un impuesto, sino que pensando que podría jugar algún rol distorsionando los mecanismos de información y el funcionamiento del sistema de precios?
There's two parts. One had to do with the influence of changing institutions over time, and the other about whether I'm right in dismissing connections between inflation and growth. Those are really separate questions. I'll try and address them separately. A lot of modern writers have stressed the importance of good institutions, you know, legal institutions, law enforcement, and so on, in economic growth. And when you think of these Rwandas and Mozambiques and Ugandas, you can sort of, you know, societies where simply any kind of law or civil society has disappeared, and obviously economic activities ground to a halt, you know, you're drawn to those kinds of theories. But there are also lots of examples of ancient. Now look at the Romans, who used to be our model of a civil society and of a legal system. Roman societies were not hostile toward investment, toward capitalism, toward you know, people could keep their income. It was a kind of low social mobility class. I mean, a big landowning family in ancient Italy, those families could last for centuries.
So in this, if good institutions mean institutions that guarantee, that ensure an investor a decent and reliable return, if his investment earns that return, it seems to me you had those societies, and Rome is one example. So there's more to it. Maybe I'm just focusing on the wrong institutions, but it seems to me that I accept the evidence of Rwanda that some kind of decent institution is going to be necessary for any useful economic activity. But on the other hand, it seems to me that it's not sufficient, that there are societies that have institutions that look to me eminently reasonable from an economist's point of view. I mean, I'm not defending ancient Rome as, like, say, a model modern democracy or something, but in the sense of the way it treats returns on investment, I think it's very modern. And yet it wasn't enough to lead to industrialization or improvement in living standards. So there's something else going on. So in my thinking, I've sort of set institutions off to one side. The inflation and growth connections, maybe so. I don't see the connection. There's no doubt that inflation distorts economic decision making and leads to a waste of resources. Maybe I should have a presumption that anything that's waste resources probably hurts economic growth. But I haven't seen models I've seen that link inflation and growth. Usually have inflation is more of what I would call a level effect, kind of drops the whole curve without changing the rate of growth of production with respect to time. That's what I meant when I said I think inflation is a bad thing and a waste of resources. I don't think it's very much connected to economic growth. I must admit, I mean, I agree, that's a question where honest people come down on both sides.
Harold Bella.
En el modelo tradicional de Solow, la apertura comercial o el comercio tendría un efecto de nivel solamente sobre el producto. Las tasas de crecimiento que uno observa en Corea da la impresión de que son mucho más que atribuibles a ese efecto de nivel. Entonces la pregunta es cómo el comercio afectaría específicamente estas tasas de crecimiento tan altas, digamos, que en el modelo solo tienen un efecto de nivel solamente.
I guess it's kind of in response to questions to that question. Push me toward thinking about learning by doing, which is capable of contributing to sustained growth, as the main growth payoff of openness, as opposed to the classical gains from trade, which of course are also present. So I think the Koreans have learned and are still learning a tremendous amount. They've gone through the production for export of so many different products, increasing in sophistication over this post-war period. I think they've accumulated a tremendous amount of productivity relevant knowledge just by their efforts to, you know, find more successful, profitable export goods. That's a factor that just isn't, you know, this traditional models just don't have a place for.
Rodrigo Vergara.
Profesor Lucas, hay algunos otros autores que han trabajado en este tema del crecimiento, como Paul Romer, por ejemplo, quien ha dicho que la fuente de crecimiento estaría en la creación de nuevas ideas, o en el caso de los países en desarrollo, en la copia de ideas de países desarrollados. ¿Qué diferencia habría en este learning by doing que usted está mencionando aquí, que uno aprendería básicamente de la relación con, o de la apertura comercial, de la relación con otros países, y este concepto de copiar ideas de otros países que tiene Romer?
I think Romer tends to somewhat overstate the distinction between these two, and he likes to talk about ideas in some pure sense unrelated to trade, like a blueprint. But I didn't learn what good French bread was by reading about it in a book or finding a blueprint for French bread in the library. I used it by going to France and noticing how much better the bread was there than the bread I could buy in Chicago. A lot of other people must have made that same remark, because now the bread that's baked in Chicago is much more close to the French frontier than it used to be. And now that's trade. I mean, and, you know, taking a vacation in Paris is just a form of exporting or importing French goods. I think my example is much more typical I mean, it's a household example, because I'm just a consumer, not really. But I think it's a much more typical example than Paul's blueprint example. The other example this whole get together here is trade. Why you people invite me here? Why don't I go to the library, Xerox the blueprints, and circulate them, if it's pure ideas that matter? I think what we all think is that sort of interaction and arguing and questioning and a process of really getting together, involving us being in the same room in the same country, is somehow that's what it's going to take for the exchange of ideas. That's what I feel. I've learned more about Argentina and Chile in the last 4 days than I've learned in the last 40 years, you know? And that's learning by doing. So I feel this blueprint thing, it's a kind of academic abstraction that doesn't fit my sense of how things really work.
Allá atrás, no alcanzo a ver bien, veo un brazo nomás.
Bueno, volviendo al tema, a la pregunta histórica de qué es lo que puede haber hecho que la economía mundial arrancase después del 1800, un poco enfrentado a esa pregunta, me recordó la misma inquietud que tenía Fernand Braudel, el historiador, y enfrentado con ese mismo dilema, él propone una idea que consiste en que la naturaleza del cambio tecnológico que habría ocurrido durante la Revolución Industrial habría permitido una menor tasa de depreciación de la inversión, porque de acuerdo a sus cálculos, la inversión bruta de las economías preindustriales, pre-1800, era similar en orden de magnitud a las que observamos hoy día, pero la inversión neta habría sido muy pequeña, porque una gran parte de los recursos económicos se tendrían que estar gastando sencillamente en reponer un capital que se agotaba muy rápido. En ese sentido hay un rol que se le asigna a la naturaleza del cambio tecnológico que hubo durante la Revolución Industrial, en particular el tema del acero. ¿Cuál es su visión de esa versión, no muy económica, pero sí con mucho análisis histórico que hizo Braudel en su minuto?
I mean, I've already said I'm in the market for a theory, so I'm not going to look down my nose at Braudel's ideas or anyone else's. I guess what I want some help on, and maybe you're offering it and I'm just not seeing it, is that I want the change in the nature of technology to kind of raise the return on human capital accumulation relative to other capital. I want inventions that can somehow be exploited by trained people to a greater extent than older inventions could, or something like that. Something that lets me helps me out in seeing the decrease in fertility, or as well as the increase in production. I want something that helps me see how we got out of this Malthusian trap. I think you're probably right that by looking in more detail at the nature of the technological changes occurring, you know, a century, in the one or two centuries before 1800, if we're going to find gold, that's probably where it's buried.
¿Una otra pregunta? Sí, por allá.
Usted planteó que el estado natural del nivel de ingreso per cápita era a que sea similar a través de los países en el tiempo, y que hoy día estamos enfrentando una situación que de alguna manera es anormal en función de la historia de la humanidad. También dijo que el proceso de convergencia que naturalmente debería darse en el próximo siglo o más adelante venía acompañado de una disminución en el crecimiento de los países hoy día más ricos. ¿Es eso necesariamente así, o el proceso de aprendizaje, de avance tecnológico, puede permitir que los países más adelantados sigan creciendo rápido y que los otros los alcancen simplemente porque ser aún más rápido? De alguna manera, ¿por qué las economías más desarrolladas hoy día crecen tan poco? ¿Ese es un proceso inevitable o tiene que ver con instituciones, tiene que ver con política? ¿Qué cree usted de eso?
We may be disagreeing about just the facts, but I want to say before I start getting into numbers, I don't believe there's any zero-sum element to economic growth whatever. In fact, I think there's probably a positive-sum element to it. The U.S. economy growth rate, per capita income growth rate in the U.S. has been like between 1% and 2% per year for as long as anybody's got data, and continues to be at that level today. So there is no there is no slowing down in the richest society. Japanese have slowed down, but on my interpretation, they've slowed down because they got rich. And anybody who gets as rich as the U.S. is going to have to be put up with this 1% to 2% per capita income growth rate. One to 2% a year isn't Korea, but you know, it's not nothing either. We'll take it. It's been done good things for us over the last century, and I'll be happy if we get it for the next, you know, 6 or 8 centuries. It is not stagnation. That's I think the main point to focus on. The growth of the poor countries in the world is not coming at the expense, at least historically, has not come at the expense of the United States. What strikes me, and I have no idea whether this is a key or not, is in the 50s and the 60s, which is exactly at the time of the recovery of Europe and the Japanese miracle, these were the highest growing periods in U.S. history, and we were trading with all these people. So in some sense, and you can think of individual examples where as your neighbor starts doing something exciting economically, big profit opportunities open up for you too. So in some sense, I think it may well be true that this, as I say, it's a positive sum game. As additional countries join in, it'll open up opportunities for neighboring countries. You just open up more possibilities for all of us. You know, somebody said before about poor countries getting ideas from the rich, but not the other way around. But that's really kind of an overstatement. I mean, there's seems like the more people generating ideas, the better off we all are, and maybe most of the flow of ideas is from high-income countries to low-income countries, but there's got to be a lot of flow in the other direction as well. So I guess that's my answer.
¿Alguna otra pregunta? Bien. Muchísimas gracias, profesor. Muchas gracias a ustedes. Buenas noches. Gracias.
Myself, but then I'm jumping up and down and waving my hands around.
Yes.
No one knows what the hell's going.
Yes. No, and then it's also good to have some color because the distance, some people sort of don't see it very well. And actually, your lecture is much easier to read or to follow if you are looking actually at the graphs.
That's what I feel.